Jim Notestein, former county commissioner and an activist in our community for a long time. It's Heritage Day here at the Matheson Museum, and it's October 23rd, 1999. Jim, we're going to talk a little bit about you, your role in the community, and some personal history and some Gainesville history here on one tape. When did you come to Gainesville?
In the 13th grade, 1961.
What brought you here?
Well, that was it, the 13th grade.
Yeah.
Decided I was going to be an astronaut.
Yeah.
And so they had a wind tunnel here, an aerospace educational program, and just my luck, when I got here, they started to tear all that apart. So shifted to chemistry, went to architecture and city planning, and then they gave me my sheepskin, and off I was.
What do you do today?
Well, a variety of things. You know, I'm fascinated by our history also in this community. Every place has a wonderful history. And one of the things that I thought I'd use sort of as a mnemonic device is the sandhill cranes, because birds, as we're coming to discover, have been engaged in their social activities as a race of creatures for maybe several hundred million years. And the sandhill cranes are particularly interesting to us because they migrate periodically from north to south over Alachua County and stay sometimes even in Alachua County to overwinter. And one of the things that's interesting about those kinds of creatures that fly in the V formation is that they take turns in leading the formation. And the reason they do that is because there's a tremendous advantage to the rest of the tribe following the leader, because the air turbulence, much like the porpoise riding the bow wave of a boat, breaks the resistance of air and is about a 70% advantage to follow in the V formation. Now, they don't always have the same leader in the V. That position rotates because it's an extra special hard job to break the wave of the air. And so they rotate in that position in leadership roles. And of course, the honking, the plaintive cries we hear of the sandhill, and this is also true for the geese and the ducks and every other V formation tribe of flying creatures, they honk to encourage, or they call out to encourage those who are in the lead. It's sort of like, row, row, row your boat, you know, because we're getting somewhere. So that kind of idea of the metaphor of the citizen as activist is a good takeoff point for using that idea of the birds and their cooperative efforts. So there are lots of other things that we could bring to that message. But one of the things that I thought I'd share is the basic difference between the types of activism motivations. Maybe there's sort of two basic kind of activists. One is sort of the Thomas Jefferson kind of person, who perhaps is in love with the American ideal of liberty and justice and equality, and finds that these measures, these goals and high ideals are worth adhering to and struggling for, even though the consequences of their not being followed may not fall too heavily on that individual's shoulders. And then there's another activist type that perhaps gives little thought to those American ideals of liberty, justice, and equality, but because of some circumstance of life, gets hit right up square the head with some aspect of their living, which causes them to be concerned that perhaps their liberties or freedoms have been infringed or somewhat affected, and for that reason they then become involved. So we might say Thomas Jefferson or Don Quixote, and a range of behaviors in between there.
Which are you?
Well, I've always been fascinated with the Alexis de Tocqueville analysis of American democracy when he visited here from France, and observed some of the outstanding and unique characteristics of the American democratic movement. And of course, Thomas Jefferson and Thomas Paine and the early folks who were involved in this idea of independence, the more I discover about these people and their motivations and their expressions of liberty, the more interesting and relevant it becomes to our present life, since these factors of liberty and loss of liberty are sort of like the yin-yang symbol that we see, where the dark and the light fish chase each other constantly in the circle but never eliminate the other. And so that there's this constant need to be vigilant, as we understand the price of liberty is vigilance, constant. So I hew, I suppose, to the Jeffersonian concepts, and he had a famous phrase that one should take a turn in public service and then go back and live on the land under the laws that you had helped to promulgate while in leadership positions, much as the cranes would take their turn at the leadership in the V. So this idea of taking an active role was interestingly expressed after finishing the graduate program. We had an opportunity, since I was primarily a bicycle person then, to help create one of the first bike paths in Alachua County on the University of Florida campus with the help of my professor, Orion Vedequist, who was the chairman of my program, and also Noel Lake, who's a retired now landscape architect of the University of Florida. And using some sort of simple academic techniques, we expressed some ideas for bike paths as an alternative to the road building frenzy which was going on nationwide, and especially at the university and this city. In fact, there was a major project to build an interstate highway across the University of Florida, and that, of course, got a lot of people's attention. So there was the contrast even there of the kind of motivations where people were reacting against a bad project and becoming involved in expressions of liberty, and those who had the preconception that perhaps freedom to move should also include non-auto forms of transportation. So we went to the City Commission finally after the university experience was so successful, and got their support for creating the Bikeway Advisory Board in the early 70s. And many of the people who were actually involved in that project, that first advisory board, are now no longer with us. But anyway, that event now has borne a lot of fruit and, of course, given a lot of opportunity for people to travel safely in our community without the use of an automobile. And following that experience, we also had quite a bit of pleasure in working with the local governments and local other activists on matters of energy conservation, which spun out of the project where GRU, our local utility, wanted to get permission to build Deer Haven 2, which was a second generating plant to handle expected needed capacity. And instead of going toward load management or conservation measures, which some had suggested would be an alternate path, the city was pushing strongly for more generating capacity. And as a consequence of that disagreement, a sort of settlement arrangement, was to create the Gainesville Energy Advisory Board. And so serving on that for several years was a very good opportunity, useful experience to understand more about the workings of local government. And then there was an experience in the mid-70s where we were going through the bicentennial operations, and there was a lot of recognition that despite the benefits that many had achieved in our culture and in this community, there were still many who were left out and yet were part of the basic foundation, the so-called agricultural aspect of Alachua County. A little side note here, I like to refer to Alachua County as Florida's first county for more than alphabetical reasons. Yes. So we have this strong agricultural base, which many would wish to deny or use as a medium to hold land out of development until it's ready to make a profit. But the object of trying to improve conditions for consumers and producers of agricultural commodities led to the creation of the Downtown Farmers Market in 1976, which was a very wonderful experience and basically was the first direct market, the first farmers market in 100 years in Alachua County, because with the recent resurgence of commercialism, young people would say, well, we don't need farmers, we have grocery stores, that sort of irony. So after the creation of that farmers market effort, which now has since moved out to the north part of the community near the well, the north side of the market, and there's been a proliferation of markets, and there's one again back downtown, there's one at the Butler Plaza, and there's also one at Hale Plantation, and there's talk of more being formed as we speak. So this is very exciting.
What do you think when you drive by those? I mean, you go, this is something I helped start.
Well, it's the interesting process. It's like the Sandhill Cranes, you know. We got there, or we're still flying, we're still flapping. You know, there's different people in the head of the V. It's wonderful. It's been an opportunity, and I like to share this perspective, that if I were to have tried to promote to this community making things better for myself, I might not have received less interest. I certainly would have received less interest in that object than if I were to say to the community, let's do something good for the community, and since I'm a member of this community, the benefits by a share accrue to me as well. So this idea of taking part in something which has a net benefit to the community inevitably can benefit those members of the community as individuals. So that difference is I think important to note. So then I became inspired with the idea of having sat in also on the Neighborhood Advisory Board, which was a creation by Sidney Knight and his wife, Grace, who are wonderful community spirits. I hope there's some note of them in the Sam Proctor files of oral history. Perhaps there is. But remarkable couple of people, and they helped to create the Gainesville Neighborhood Advisory Board, which didn't quite last because it was created by the government rather than by the community. So there's a difference in that sort of avenue. But in any case, I had reached a point to which I thought that a nearer to the front of the V was a place for me. So I ran for the city commission. Now there were seven candidates at that time, and I didn't come in last, but I didn't come in first. But I was moving up in the V. And so as a consequence of that, though, apparently there was a stimulating effect upon others in the community. And Gary Gordon, the next cycle, ran successfully as the first environmentalist city commissioner in the city of Gainesville's history, an avowed environmentalist who had been part of the Catfish Alliance, who was sort of himself a musician, troubadour, activist, anti-nuclear person who had gotten quite a bit of attention to the subject of the transshipment of nuclear fuels and nuclear waste through Alachua County, which I must say still goes on. But nevertheless, it raised that subject to the public level higher than it had ever been raised before. And so after Gary's presentation and success, a little serendipitous sidebar here, there was a gentleman, Ken Fonero, who's the most interesting and charming gentleman, used to work with the governor's energy office in New Jersey. And one night in the early 70s, he was watching, this would be late 70s, he was watching television up there. And there was a story on the news of a mayor with a guitar around his neck, talking to his manager. And Ken turned to his wife, Andy, and said, wouldn't it be neat if we could live in a town where the management and the leadership seemed to be so in tune with each other, I mean, the musical metaphor. And so Ken came to Gainesville because of Gary Gordon. Now, as a result, perhaps, of Ken being here, there are more Energy Star homes and buildings in Alachua County than there are in any other community in America, because Ken has brought with him a very refined sensitivity and talent to be able to help people, builders, homeowners, whomever, to make their homes as energy efficient as possible. In fact, I embarked on a little project which rang the bell for the most energy efficient renovated home in America a couple years ago, thanks to Ken. Didn't know it was possible, but he made it an opening opportunity by leading that particular V. So then Gary ran, was successful. Later on, I decided, well, let's try this again in a different venue, County Commission. It was like, the metaphor is the belling the cat. I'm not sure if you've, the little childhood story, the mice are being terrorized by this cat. Well, the cat was the county commission at that time. There was a comprehensive plan that Alachua County had adopted some years in the early 80s as a result of growth management legislation. That county commission, though, had violated Alachua County's comprehensive plan some 200 times by basically giving permission to special interests to develop agricultural land into some sort of commercial or residential mega project that exceeded the intentions of growth management, but nevertheless was awarded approval. And so for that reason, 6,000 Alachua County citizens had organized into a Citizens Conservation Planning Coalition and were suing the county commission, the citizens suing their government. I mean, this is sort of a Jeffersonian reflection of when the king is misbehaving, someone must do something about it. So here are all these citizens wringing their hands, oh, what shall we do, oh, what shall we do? And I respected these people because they were persons with whom I'd worked on these previous projects. Well, I remembered the little story of the childhood tale of, you know, the mice thought it was a great idea to put a bell on the cat, but who was going to put the bell around the neck of the cat? I will. And it worked. Not by much of a margin, but it doesn't matter. Plus one is enough. So,
What did you learn from your first run that made the second run?
Well, the first run, the gentleman who was running put a hat on his head, and the hat band said, campaign headquarters. It was sort of the Cool Hand Luke approach to things. And of course, having a more serious grounding and having have developed a lot more connections and a larger network, and basically I was flying in a larger V formation several years later, from 79 to 84, was a chance to either move up in the V or be, as you see the Sandhill Cranes assembling in their sort of random motion as they get ready to either take off or leave. They're sort of mixing their groups. They're deciding who they're going to fly with. And some of it's, you know, their families, and some of it's their, you know, people they've been eating with or resting with. So there's this voluntary association that the Sandhill Cranes form up. And so this formative process, where I've been circulating in different formations around various projects, gave me an added credibility and added experience. So the that program was interesting, and like a postgraduate degree, 4 years of higher education at the public service sector, learning all kinds of things about Florida's first county, its administration, multi-billions dollars of assets in our community, multi-million dollar budgets, you know, tremendous responsibilities, standing on the pinnacle of the law, doing what was called upon to be done at the moment. One of the first interesting projects was, hadn't been in office 2 weeks. Hello? Yes? You don't say. Said our landfill was operating illegally. Looked into it? You're right. And so as a consequence, thanks to some citizens who were on the ball, people flying in the formation, we now set the pace for lining underground storage tanks and also landfills, because the landfill thing was very important. The landfill was being operated illegally with all sorts of things that I won't go into the details about, but could be examined by looking at the history in the local publication, because they covered that very well at the time. And then, oh, early in 1985, a young woman comes before the commission with this mason jar full of amber-colored water, and she said, "This is the water we have to drink." 34th Street and Archer Road. I mean, it's right outside the city limits, right next to GRU's water mains, but they were on wells. Who on the commission will come help me discover the source of this problem and help us resolve it? Well, it fell on me again because I kind of volunteered. We walked in the neighborhoods. Everybody there had problems that were incredible. Deaths, birth defects, all sorts of tumors, dead pets, hair falling out. It was terrible. And this had been known by people who should have done something about the fact that they knew about it. Well, anyway, turned out this woman was Penny Wheat. Aha. So she was an obvious person who had kind of like the secondary path of, you know, appreciating the fact that the American ideals of justice and truth and that sort of thing. But when she got whacked, she came right to the front of the V and became a county commissioner herself and serves to this day admirably. And I don't think there's been a better margin of winning that's been held by any commissioner than her in some history of this community.
When you were on the county commission,
yes,
it was never easy. It was all you.
Well, that's the dynamic of government. In fact, that's why you have an odd number of representatives on a body, is so that there can be always the settlement of the issue. One evening, for example, two commissioners were out of town. There were only three to govern the meeting. So we pulled out an agenda list of all sorts of progressive things that we wanted to put on the table, got them passed, and the next week when the others came back, those were all thrown off the table again. But it was the idea that now, 10 years later, all but one of those things have been approved and are now accepted as standard operating procedure. The one that still hasn't been adopted is to adopt Robert's Rules of Order. The City Commission, whenever time it convenes a newly elected commissioner, they swear them all in and acknowledge by vote that they will operate by Robert's Rules of Order. The commission has a so-called commission's rules, the last of which says that if you break any of the others, it doesn't really matter. So the parliamentary procedure, perhaps the reflection on this sad current behavior of the lack of complete consistency with judicial and parliamentary process might be reflected on a historical fact that won a Pulitzer Prize for the man who wrote the story about it, one Buddy Davis, who got a Pulitzer Prize in 1969 for writing about the fact that Alachua County was the last county in America to be desegregated. So this sort of plantation residue of the rule by fiat rather than the rule by law, or the law that comes from fiat rather than well-considered justice, is an interesting reflection of our true history. And although we don't wear our bracelets in public, there is a certain amount of order that a residual plantation society tends to enforce effectively by one means or another. But anyway, so then from following the Jeffersonian dictum of serving and then going back to the land to live under the laws promulgated while on service call, there was an interesting observation, a group called Friends of Alachua County. Now, this had been stimulated by an editorial in the daily paper that was written in May of 1985. And the editorial suggested that what Florida needed was a group called Friends of Florida, because they were talking about the successful group called Friends of Oregon, which had been created a few years earlier to help administer in Oregon the comprehensive plan there and growth management strategies and environmental protection and energy management and those sorts of intelligent policies that you'd expect governments to follow to. Well, so this light went off in several people's heads and said, ah, Friends of Oregon, Friends of Florida, Friends of Alachua County. I mean, if you want to create a big tent, why not create a tent that says Friends of Alachua County? And then everybody who was not a friend of Alachua County could go to the other tent, and who would raise their hand to say they weren't a friend of Alachua County? So, good mechanism. So then it was realized that with a change of the publishing board of the daily paper, the New York Times syndicate member, There was a definite change in 86, because that's when Penny Wheat got elected. And a special delegation of local development interests went to the chairman of the board of the New York Times in New York City and pleaded with them for a person to be sent to manage this local chain paper in a way which would not impede the objectives of the, let's say, the development interests, those who would transform this community in a way which was a little faster they would wish and a little more to their benefit, because numbers was the game and they wanted more numbers, more residents, more sales, more this, more that. And of course that plays right in the hand of much of commercial journalism, because that's basically how the freight's paid. So there was a sea change in the New York Times syndicate paper called the Gainesville Sun, and as a consequence the so-called hammering began. It was a very famous phrase, and all sorts of plots and schemes and interesting activities, some of which got exposed. Chambergate was most interesting, where one of the little mice inside one of the other little nests decided to go public with what was known about the relationships between the president of the Chamber of Commerce and the president of the University of Florida to close down, to cut off discussions by certain university professors in the public domain of Alachua County's development policies, and to also focus most viciously on some of the behaviors and activities of some of the elected officials. And this was done in a very conspiratorial setting, which is also well history documented. So these sorts of things were quite interesting. People who had been Democrats all their life, like the county sheriff, changed parties. Special PACs were created to try and draw the groups, you know, to this great fray. And I suppose that many of us who graduated as a result of those investments to civilian life again were pleased that we didn't live in a more southern government, because we might have woken up disappeared one day. But in any case, so then Friends of Alachua County decided to build a newspaper, because it was realized that unless you buy ink by the barrel, you probably don't have much opportunity to express yourself. Writing letters to the editor once a month is not exactly the most effective medium of communication when those letters are subject to editing. So Friends of Alachua County Talk, Fact, was created. And there have been publications called Fact before, but it's been published now almost for 10 years and represents, along with other local publications, Iguana, Moon, and so forth, an interesting aspect of Alachua County, which I'm told has a greater number for its population of locally based communication media than any other community in America. Which, and these little publications still exist. I mean, there's been a rise and fall throughout the country of little communication efforts from the grassroots, but these remain. Now, there are electronic versions of these, many of these media forms that I mentioned. Interesting. So now we're into the 90s. We're almost into the next century. And we're doing this project now called Leadership 21, which is basically the little red hen. Now, that's another little childhood metaphor which I think many people can reflect on and remember, that when the little red hen was looking about in her community for people to help her do this and do that, she asked everybody, and not everybody wanted to play, but she did it herself because it was worth doing. And in the end, of course, she decides to feed her chicks with the bread she's baked. Maybe we'll open the story up a bit at that point, as I was suggesting earlier, that everyone in the community can feed off the planting efforts and the baking efforts of the little red hen. So we're looking now to this citizenship training mechanism, because there is a process which I have experienced, which many people have experienced, which even more people have observed, that there is this evolution, if one is conscious, of the mechanism of growth as a citizen. And this growth as a citizen is wonderful, because in America we have these grand principles to which we can adhere, to which we can admire the proponents and the precedents of, and we can conduct our own flavors. It's like the chicken soup for the community. We can build our own recipes, our own Foxfire books, and so on. So right now we've been, for the last two or three months, we've been assembling recipes from people in the community. And is it wonderful? I've made 200 phone calls, 100 letters have gone out. We're starting to get a flood now of these recipes. One-page brief summaries of successful projects conducted by people in this community in a very short summary format, and at the bottom it says, for further information, and da-da-da. Now this will go in a loose-leaf ring binder cookbook, and we will use this as one of the main teaching medium for a class which is being offered in the fall B term of Santa Fe Community College called Citizen as Leader. And the object will be, over a very short period of time, to imbue those persons interested in becoming more effective activists, the mechanism of that activism, and based not on some academic theoretical ideology or somewhere else, but what really took place here. The fact, for example, that the 4 or 5 year long project to encourage General Electric to disconnect its atomic weapons program from its appliance program, basically to get out of nuclear weapons, the major force in the project that was done worldwide, turns out, by the people in California who began the program, Gainesville, Florida. There was the Net Ban Amendment, there was the interesting amendment called Save Our Homes, which was a constitutional amendment for the state of Florida, which was basically to limit the rate of property tax increase to no more than 3% a year, because many homestead people were losing their land, if they lived on a lake especially, because people with lots of money could come bid up the price of their land, and the property appraiser would say, neighbor's land $3 million, your land $3 million, can't pay tax, too bad. So that Saving Our Homes was another measure that passed, in part due to work here in this community. Lots of things have happened. Cassini flyby, you know, the vehicle crashed when it went too close to Mars. The plutonium-powered vehicle that took its gravity slingshot by Earth to go off to Jupiter, well, there was enough effort globally, led by people in Gainesville, to make JPL, Jet Propulsion Laboratory, adjust the trajectory altitude above the Earth from 300 miles to 700 miles. Pretty cosmic, but at least it doubled the chances of getting a plutonium dust off, which could have had consequences to the populations. So the idea is that somebody can do things. You don't have to be anointed necessarily. You have to have experience. You have to have a sort of a preconception, a vision, or you can wait and get whacked by reality to come into the V, or to struggle up toward the V. But I think the Jeffersonian approach is better, the de Tocqueville approach, the knowledge, the sense of history, the roadmap, the knowledge of place, the spirit of the place, the energy, the tremendous unique energy that every place holds, the magic of place, the sacred qualities of place. These are the things that, though, for those who are aware of them, of those qualities, and no judgment about those who may be more or less aware, this is just the reality. In the stream there's gravel and there's nuggets. This leadership program is sifting for the nuggets, because we think that with more nuggets, you know, maybe better leadership, maybe better examples, and this can be contagious. So there are many groups in the community who, for various reasons, are assembling their tribes, assembling their V formations, and taking turns in seeing who can sustain the lead of the V, because it's not that they're going to stay there. It's a tiring position. And as long as there's others in the V, we have the leadership has those to fall back on, and people take their turn in being the leadership between the high and the low. The precincts, there are 53 precincts in Lacs County, and not a single one of them has a monthly meeting. And at the year 2000, when we elect a president, every precinct in Lacs County, along with all other counties in America, all 3,000 of them, can elect almost 500 precinct representatives to represent in this pyramid between the 5-county school board and city commissioners and the huge base of nearly 200,000 people, a middle transmission body, the 500 precinct representatives, who could come forward and speak with legitimacy and logic about measures that affected our multi-million dollar budgets. Every precinct taxed over $10 million times 53, big numbers. Where's the money going? Staff and consultants and special interests pull the string. So I think this idea of participatory democracy has more relevance than ever before. Economic democracy is as important as political democracy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim.